you, look at this day. Absolutely stunning. It's around about 12 degrees Celsius. Not much wind. A little bit, but not a lot. And just a beautiful, beautiful Sunday afternoon. We've been in lockdown for a few weeks, so it's finally good to get out and about and get back on the bike again. We had a 5 kilometre restriction zone. You couldn't go more than 5 kilometres away from your house. So I haven't been able to get out and about and go for a ride. But those yellow flowers you can see there, they're canola crops. You'll see a few of those around here as we're riding. It's really nice to see those, that sea of yellow flowers, especially when they all come in, it's just solid yellow. So today I thought I'd do a little bit of a different video, just have a bit of a ride around, a bit of a chat about things that have been happening, and do all that while we're taking a bit of a tour around the countryside. So I hope you all have been well, and I'm sure the people that are following the channel from around my area and from Victoria will be glad to be getting out and about again. I'm starting to see a few bikes getting about. But today I thought I'd have a bit of a talk about the NC750X, this bike right here. I haven't really done a bit of a review on it. I've done about, I don't know, I haven't got my glasses on. Things around about 8,000 or 9,000 kilometres on the bike since I've owned it, and I thought it was time to give you a review and a bit of feedback on what the bike's like to own, and if I like it or not, and yeah, what I think could be better, and would I buy the new version that's just come out. So I bought this bike to replace my Vulcan 1700. I was looking for something a bit lighter, a bit more practical, a bit easier to ride around town. I suppose a bit of a do-it-all bike, and also something that was better on petrol than what the Vulcan 1700 was. I think I was getting about 45 miles per gallon, 40 miles per gallon out of it. On this bike I'm getting about 70, so I'll often see the economy at about 2.7, 3 litres per 100 kilometres, and yeah, this thing's just fantastic on fuel. I would spend $25 to fill the Vulcan 1700 up. This bike, it cost me about $12 to fill up, and this will go further on a tank of fuel than what my Vulcan 1700 did, so I'm noticing a big difference fuel economy wise, which I really like. I like the fact that this thing's pretty frugal on fuel, and yeah, so round town it's fantastic. It weighs about 219 kilos wet, fully fueled, but it carries its weight down low because it's a parallel twin engine, but the cylinders are laid down and forward, so the weight's down low there. This is not a fuel tank, this is a storage section, which I'll show you a little bit later, and the fuel tank's actually under the seat, so the center of mass is pretty low, and you can really feel that when you're sort of just moving around and changing direction. So even though it's a 219 kilogram bike, it actually rides a lot lighter than that. Well, to me it does anyway, especially coming off a bike that weighed close to 400 kilograms. Look at those, that canola crop's really coming in nicely now. Looks beautiful. So where was I? Yeah, so weight wise, you know, I see some people say that 200 kilograms, or if you get over 200, they start to call it a heavy bike, or 220 starting to get heavy. In my mind it's not, especially in a bike like this where the weight's carried down low. If you've got a bike that's top heavy, then I'd say yeah, 220 would start to be, it'd feel like it's a heavier bike than it actually is. But yeah, so weight wise I'm very happy with. Fuel economy, I'm really happy with the bike. Now the power, I've always found, because this engine has actually started life as a four-cylinder Honda car engine, and they just lopped two cylinders off and turned it into a motorcycle engine. So what that means is that the way it develops its power is more like a car than a motorcycle. So it's not an engine that you rev out to get your power. All you have to do is just give it light input of the throttle and the bike just goes. It's like it's got a very effortless feeling to it, and you don't have to rev it out to get it to go. It this is Lake Learmonth, and we're starting to get some water in. We've had a bit of rain this winter, so it's good to see that start to fill up again. That was a few years ago. This lake and all the lakes around here were bone dry. You could walk across when we had our droughts, but they're all starting to fill up again, which is really good news. So, where was I? Yeah, so power-wise, I'll put what the horsepower is. I don't even remember now, and to be honest, I don't really care because it's more than adequate. It's completely fine for the purpose of this bike and what it's intended for. So it's got all the power and torque that I require. It has enough torque to get you off the line very quickly, and it has enough horsepower to allow you to pass cars at highway speeds. And sitting on the highway, it sits on the highway very nicely. I was worried, being lighter than my previous bike, that it might get blown around in the wind a bit, but I have not had an issue at all, and it's pretty windy around here. We get some pretty high winds, and the bike's fantastic in the wind, I'd have to say, for its size. I have no qualms about that at all. So sitting at highway speeds, doing your 100, 110 as we do around here, it certainly holds its own, no problems at all. And then when you want to pass a car, there's plenty of power just to pass. I can be sitting in top gear, sixth gear at 100 k's an hour, which is about 60 miles an hour, and just roll the throttle on and pass. I don't have to drop it down a gear or anything like that. It's totally fine. So the sixth gear does feel like a bit of an overdrive, so it's not revving a lot at highway speeds. I think I'll check it up ahead, but I think from memory it's around about 3,400 RPM at 60 miles or 100 k's an hour. So it's doing it pretty easy. Comfort-wise, seat comfort and just rider ergonomics, I find the bike very comfortable. I'm 6'1" and weigh about 90 kilos. And yeah, it fits me quite nicely. I have done a couple of modifications to the bike, and that is I've added a throttle lock because it doesn't have cruise control. I wish it did have cruise control, but it doesn't. So I've added a throttle lock, which is this one right here, and the brand, actually, and the name of it escapes me at the moment, but I'll put that on screen. And yeah, it does what it's intended to do, just locks the throttle so you can just give your hand a bit of a rest. Does it replace cruise control? No, cruise control is far superior, but it's at least gives you the ability to give your hand a rest on longer trips, which is better than nothing. So yeah, I don't regret installing that or buying that at all. And the other modification I've done is to the seat. The seats on this particular model, they tend to sort of slope forward, and I don't find it too uncomfortable for about an hour or so, but any longer than that and I'm starting to sort of squirm. I think 2 hours is I've pretty well had enough of the seat. But there is a modification you can do where you just lift the front of the seat up about an inch, and that's it's amazing how much difference it makes, because it sort of rolls your body back onto the wider part of the seat, and you're sort of cupped in a little valley section, if you like. and it makes it so much more comfortable. I haven't had that modification on for a while. I've just been testing it, but I've got used to it the way it was. But now with this today, I've just put that little adapter back on and giving it another test, and yeah, it's definitely more comfortable this way, and it's I could see myself spending longer in the seat like this. So that little modification I designed and 3D printed. If anybody wants that STL file, if you're into 3D printing, you want to print one yourselves, let me know and I'll tell you where you can download it for free. It's I'm just sharing it freely with people. And it works quite well. And you may want to modify it, adapt it a little bit, but that's one of the issues that I have with this bike. It was the seat, and not having any cruise control, which, you know, is certainly not a deal breaker. And the screen I find, I don't really have a problem with it, actually, as it is. I did buy a little adapter. You may have seen in some of my videos where it just sits on there, clips on, and gives you a little bit more wind protection. But actually noticing today while I'm riding with the seat mod, and the seat just lifts up at the front, it sort of sits me back a little bit more, and I'm getting clean air over my helmet. I wear earplugs for ear noise protection. So yeah, this from now on into summer, I definitely won't be putting that little deflector back on. And to be honest, I'll probably leave it off all the time now. I'm quite happy with this as the way it is. So overall, the only thing I've really changed is I've added this little throttle lock and lifted the front of the seat up, and other than that, I'm completely happy with the bike. It's been a great buy for me. It's just so versatile, it's agile, it sits really solidly on the highway, like at 100 k's. It's just, you know, it does it effortlessly. What are we? Trying to see what here we go. Like, I'm doing, that's just under 3,000. I thought it was 3,400, but it's just under 3,000 at 100 kilometers an hour. And yeah, it does it easy. I haven't really gone too up on the bike, mainly because I want to adjust the suspension to accommodate the extra weight of a passenger. And I need a special tool, and I went to the Honda dealer to try and buy that tool. They had nothing that would fit the bike, and I've looked online on eBay and things, and I just wasn't sure if what they were selling was actually going to fit the collar on the rear shock to adjust the preload. So I've sort of I've just put it off for a bit. Eventually I will get something adjusted, but the way the suspension's set up now is pretty good for me. I don't have any issues with it. The front's not adjustable at all, but it's fine. If anything, I'd say the front suspension, the compression damping is probably a little bit too strong, in that when you hit a bump, it's a bit harder than I think it needs to be, primarily because the suspension has so much suspension travel. It's got a lot of travel on the suspension on this bike, and when you hit that bump, it's a sharper jolt than I think it needs to be. So I'd like to be able to adjust the compression damping just to back that off a whisker. But otherwise, other than that, I'm quite happy with the suspension. The stock tyres that came on the bike, I've been happy with, very happy with actually, because on dry, wet, and in gravel, they've been fine. They're not a tyre that I take on muddy sections, but for just the sort of roads I ride on, they've been absolutely fine, and they're the same tyres I'll be putting on when it's due to replace them. So it's done now. I think it's 8,000 or 9,000 k's. I'll check a little bit later. And the tyres are still showing good life, and they're wearing well, so I can't complain about that. The other thing I'm not super fussed about, I really like the dash and the layout, but the brightness. When the sun's behind you and shining directly onto it, surprisingly, that's when it's the easiest to read. Everything just lights up and it's super easy to read. But when the sun's coming at you, it sort of goes into shade and it gets harder to read, especially with my aging eyes. Some more canola. It would be better if it was brighter. So it's an LCD. If it was TFT, then that'd be fine. But I really like the layout and what it shows me. I've got my fuel, I've got my range to empty, I've got fuel economy, tack, time, date, speed, everything's there that I need. So I'm happy with that. And it's just a nice small little unit, and it works well. The riding position I find very comfortable, very natural. So I don't feel a need to change that. My legs are comfortable. See where my knees are up. Coming up just underneath this lip here. If you're 6'4", you might be starting to run out a bit of room, but no, I find it very comfortable. Now the new model of this, the 2021 model, they've made a few changes, and most of the changes I like. I think they're for the better, especially the seat. Apparently they've reworked the seat and it's a lot more comfortable. I don't think it's perfect, but I think it's a lot more comfortable than what this seat is. But the big thing that they did that I don't like is they've reduced the suspension travel. For me, this is a bike that I'm quite happy to take on and off-road. When I say off-road, I mean gravel roads and smaller tracks without being too rough. But with lower suspension than what this has, I don't know if I'd be so keen to do that. I think I've turned it from more of an adventure bike, as this is, to a commuter, really, which can do highway work no problems at all, because I think they've changed the gearing in fifth and sixth, and it now has taller gearing. Actually, while we've been talking, I've completely missed the turn I was going to take to get off the bike and have a bit of a look around it. So we'll go back and pick up that turn. You can see now this, what I'm talking about, the sunlight coming over my shoulder, it's becoming easier to read. And actually this looks a bit dimmer. I think somewhere I might have mucked up my brightness settings. That should be brighter than it actually is. I think I've got that turned down. I was mucking around with the settings doing something the other day, and I was scrolling through things, and I think I've turned the brightness down. So I'll have to adjust that when I get home, because normally the sun's over me on my shoulder over this, it's much brighter. So if I was to replace this bike right now, it wouldn't be with the new NC750X. I think I'd prefer to keep this model. But I would look at the Africa Twin is what I would go for to replace this. I want to get up to the top of that little mountain over there. There's a turn off I can take up here, I think, which should take me over that way. Comparing this to the Africa Twin, the Africa Twin's going to give me a lot more comfort, a lot more wind protection, and just be a bit more plusher bike to ride, which would be nice. But I'm also going to gain weight, and the weight's going to be carried a bit higher than what this is, so that's a bit of a downside for me. And I'm also going to lose fuel economy, which is although it's pretty good, it's still not going to be what this is. And after being back on the bike right now, I'm sort of thinking I'm quite happy to hang on to this for a little bit longer, I think. So would I recommend this motorcycle to people? Yes, 100% I would. It's a great little bike, great run around, great on the highway. I find it really good on gravel roads. The power delivery is nice, it's effortless. The gear shifts are nice. This is a manual, you can get DCT, but the DCT version is not available in Australia, or was not. The new model, the 2021, isn't even available here anymore, so they've dropped the NC750X from their lineup altogether, which is really amazing when you consider this is one of Honda's best-selling bikes worldwide. So whether just people in Australia just aren't into them or didn't take to them, so they thought we won't be doing that again. I don't know, but it's a fantastic little bike. And I like the fact that, you know, it's a bike that you see a track and you want to get somewhere, you can just sort of work it out, and if it's a bit of a dirt road or a bit bumpy, doesn't matter, you just ride through and get to where you want to go. And, you know, having a cruiser, I look at my Vulcan Vaquero, which I really did like that bike. I thought it was an excellent bike. It wasn't perfect. It has had its issues, but I did like that bike. But I do love having this flexibility to go. I feel like I can go wherever I want, whenever I want. If I see a dirt road I want to take, I just take it and just go and explore and have a look. It's certainly things I wouldn't have done on the Vaquero. Even like on a narrow road like this, and you want to turn around all of a sudden, well, you know, you've really got to sort of start making plans on how to do that. And, you know, trying to back it up, if you're trying to back it up any type of hill, is it's just not even worth thinking about. So it's a bike where you've got to ride it differently. You've got to start making plans. If you're going to park somewhere, always park with the front wheel higher than the rear. So if that meant riding into a spot or backing into a spot, that's what I'd do. It just made my life a lot easier getting out again. Whereas something like this, you know, I still use that same practice, because why make life harder for myself than it needs to be? But it's just, everything's just so much easier. Bit of loose stuff here. It's just so nice being out, free, on such a beautiful day. We've had it's been a cold winter. When I say cold, hasn't been colder than normal, but we've had more cold days than usual, if that makes sense. Often we'll get a few cold days and a little bit of a reprieve and a few cold days, but it's just sort of been relentlessly cold this winter. And I'm wondering if that means that it's going to be a really hot summer, because the previous winter was mild, I thought, and then our summer was mild. So we could be getting our 46, 48 degree days this summer, Celsius that is. This is just a nice little area I discovered. I thought I wanted to get to the top of this sort of little mountain and found this little road and came up and had a bit of a look. The stones that worry me on these sort of tracks are the ones that are pointy and sticking up on these tyres. So I go to lengths to make sure that I avoid those. And that's the beauty of this bike, is you can just change direction pretty quickly and easily, so it's not a big, not a lot of trouble to do that. bit of a steep hill here heading down. Just trying to find that little spot I found the other day. Wouldn't normally cut that corner like that, but I could see through the trees, there's no cars coming, so. This corner's a bit of a blind corner. Getting a bit rougher now. I think this is a lot rougher than actually last time I was here. I think the rain must have washed out. It must have washed out a fair bit of the road there, I'd say. Yeah, this is the spot I was thinking of. Here we are. Let's make sure she's not going to fall over. There's my NC750X. You're thinking about buying this particular model second hand, there's nothing I could say to say don't buy it. Being Honda, it's going to be reliable. I'm doing all my servicing myself. It's easy to service. Even the valve inspections are easy because it's based on that like a more of a car system where you've got a nut that you adjust to adjust the valve spacings or the clearances, and it's just remove the radiator and you've got instant access to it right here. I did the valve clearances on my Triumph Thruxton 900 years ago, and it was a lot more work. I had to remove camshafts, and I did a lot of research on how to do it and watch videos and took notes and got a workshop manual and did the clearances, but that was one of the big appealing factors of this was when it was time to do the valve clearances that it's going to be super easy. So another reason to keep the bike, really. The other thing that it has is a single disc front end, brake wise. Now I see a lot of people complaining about the new Harley Davidson Sportster S only has a single disc front end. Well, the Sportster S weighs about the same as this bike, and it has the same size. That's a 320mm disc on the front. It has the same size disc on the front, and I have no problems with these brakes at all. Having a twin disc front end will, depending on the size of disc, if they're two discs at 320, then you will have increased stopping power for sure. But generally they're smaller discs, so you do lose a bit of stopping power by going to a smaller disc. And the other thing is, when you have two discs on your front end, you also have two calipers. And all that is adding weight to the unsprung mass. So that's the weight that's been carried below the suspension. And so that means changing direction, it will change direction a little bit slower because you've got that extra weight on the front wheel. So on the Sports Arrest, the fact that it's got one, after having this bike, one disc this size on this weight motorcycle doesn't worry me one little bit. If I was doing a lot of, you know, racing around on it and accelerating, stopping, racing it basically, then yes, I'd want two front discs because the disc's going to get hot and, you know, you're going to lose braking efficiency by the constant slamming the brakes on, accelerating, slamming the brakes on. In that case, you would want two discs, but who rides like that on the road? Like, if you do ride like that on the road, well then yes, you'll want your two front discs, but if you're riding normally, it's not going to be an issue. It really isn't. Now the other clever thing that Honda have done here, this rear disc brake is actually the cutout from here. It gets cut out of this front disc and then becomes the rear disc. So I think that's very clever engineering. So you can see here what I'm talking about. The engine is laying pretty flat. All the weight that would be sitting up here, normally cylinder head wise, is down here. This fuel tank is now down here under the seat. So it's a really clever design. I've really done a good job of this bike. When we're talking about storage and things like that, you can see here that takes my full face helmet, which is a medium size showy, no problems. So when I get somewhere, I just put my gloves and things into the helmet, drop it in there, lock it up, and walk away from the bike, which is super handy. And then here is your fuel tank, and the tank is just under the seat here. It's just a really practical, functional motorcycle, and still fun to ride. You can see tyres wise, still got plenty of tread on these, on the rear. Front's looking fine as well. So they're lasting well. I'll definitely be putting those tyres back on. And they're the Bridgestone Battle Wings, they're called. I see people overseas putting guards and things and screens and panniers and all sorts of stuff on it, but for me, I just like it. Just nice and clean and simple as it is. When I first popped that seat up, the last time I did the mod, it was sort of annoying me. It wasn't long after I bought the bike. But seeing it here today and the way it was riding, it's fine. I don't mind it. I did see somebody do this and then cut all this back. I'm not even going to worry about it, because that way when I sell it, I can just remove that mod, pop the seat back down, and it's good as new. Okay, I think that does it for this video. If you have any questions about the NC750X, particularly this model, definitely let me know in the comments below. And yeah, I'll let you know whatever you need to know. If you've made it this far in this video, thanks heaps for watching today, and hopefully I'll see you all again in the next one. Bye for now.